started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone, and the sun went down as I crossed the hill, and the town lit up. The world got still. I'm learning to fly. The plane got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days may not return. Rocks might melt, and the sea may burn. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
Is better than, well, popcorn on a Saturday night at the movies, you know. Shoot! Oh, man. Gotta stretch that baby out a little bit, get ourselves feeling more like refined, huh? Get ourselves feeling more like refined, huh, Angel? Oh, get up here. You don't want to? Okay. Okay, you lucky girl. You're just such a lucky kid. We're so lucky to have you. We are. She's a beautiful girl. You know, dog after my own heart, kind of like the energy of one of my first dogs when I was a kid come back to haunt me in my old age. What a beautiful haunting it is, man, let me tell you. Love you, Angel baby. Oh, that starts getting me back to beginnings, you know, shoot. You know, beginnings, man. You know, you're going to be a trucker, you're going to go trucking, you got to like learn how to drive at some point in your as yet unfostered career. And you know, most kids first they learn their own, what do they call that, biped mobility. And then they move on to the tricycle, you know, and then ultimately the bicycle, which is secretly a preparation for the automobile, huh, Angel? Yeah. Which is more properly called a car these days. And oh, well, car's a car. But that's how most folks do it. Of course, now, you know, young Mr. Coyote here, he ain't gonna live like everybody else. I mean, he does do those things, true, but, you know, now we're on a family farming operation, and you know, it also we also have 120 head of cattle, you know, and so we got big old hay ranch, and you know, various and sundry little properties all over the place that we do pasturing and different things with, grow crops and do different things with. And on top of all that, then Pappy has that little trucking business on the side I've told you about, hauling that coal. So here I am, a little kid, you know, and next thing I know, you know, well, first we get a old, worn-out car that somebody set over a ditch, and that's our stationary play car. There's no engine or transmission in it or anything. It's all been robbed. It's just basically a body with the seats still in it and stuff. And so we can pretend driving that, and of course, as I've told you, it's like I was born to drive, man, you know, I was driven. So I went and, you know, played in that play car. And I could feel the motion of it. I could feel the movement of it. And just as a tiny kid, 2-3 years old, I could feel the restlessness in my soul coming up. wondering what lay beyond those mountains and if this was all there was to living, you know, because it sure seemed kind of cloistered to me. Now, I couldn't have said that, but that's what it felt like, looking back on it now. But it was also had its finer points. You know, life has its little moments, both good and bad. Sometimes the good far outweigh the bad, and sometimes they damn better because the bad's going to be a lot. Or we should call it the rough, you know, because it's really not so good and bad, it's just rough. And sometimes it's rougher than others, but you know, it's kind of a cowboy existence, you know, and you're a buckaroo and you're expected to get on that old bronc and ride away into the sunset, make a friend out of him right away. And there's a lot of us can do it, but you know, it's got to be the right animal too. Not every animal will submit to that. And not every human being has a proclivity to it, just like driving. But we are the buckaroos. So we start out in that old wrecked car over the ditch, and we move on from there. Now when I'm like about, hey, Angel, it's a neighbor home, huh? We're hanging out at my friend's place in the hills up here above Boulder, Colorado. It's a beautiful place, man. It's an awesome country. I know you can see the reflection of it in the window. But Angel knows there's somebody here. Look at that. Yes, she does. How you doing, dude? Okay, we'll get ourselves all in position here now. We had to move in from the great outdoors because, well, it's getting chilly out there. You know, gosh, me and Angel just needed to be indoors for a bit, didn't we, hon? Yes, we did. Yes, we did. We just needed to be indoors for a bit. Where we can kind of work on things together, huh? Yeah. Angel the love dog. Yes, she is. Whole chapter 5 is going to be all about Angel, huh? You betcha. It's Grandpa Coyote and Angel the love dog coming to you from the mountains above Boulder, Colorado, working here on chapter 5 of Truckin with Grandpaw. Yeah. And it's a rockin' book, and Angel says so, don't you, baby? Yes, you do. Yes, you do. You say so. Okay, so we're like learning how to drive, you know? Because you're a young kid in a farming and ranching and trucking operation, and babies, when thrashing time comes around especially, they need every hand they can get. So if you're going to lead a long and illustrious career in the transportation industry, that's an awfully good place to start. Because by the time you're 5 years old, they got you on a tractor out there gathering up shucks to take to the thrashing machine. And dang, it takes a lot of hands to do that. So there you are at 5 years old, sitting on the seat of this hard old tractor. Yeah, Angel's going to sit here and encourage us now for the rest of this video. She's such a sweetheart. I tell you, I'd be lost without this little dog. I'm glad she's making this journey with us here. But anyway, 5 years old, and you got to learn the basics, man. So, you know, they start you out. Push the clutch down, you put the tractor in first gear, you let the clutch up slow and smooth like, so you don't knock the guy off the wagon in back. Well, of course, I knocked him off 2 or 3 times before I finally got the hang of it. I mean, you know, it took every ounce of strength I could get to hold my feet down on that clutch until they were ready to move. Giddy up, then you let it up, oh, and the tractor rears up and the guy falls off the wagon, and everybody's hooting and hollering, and You know. But you got to learn somewhere. So, in that vein, you know, besides working a little bit in the fields as soon as you're able, you know, you're big enough to be able to depress a clutch and so forth and turn a steering wheel, then you're out there rocking around in your cousin's play car. Now, your cousin has this old Plymouth that he doesn't know what to do with, so he gives it to my dad and says, give it to your kids and let them learn how to drive in that thing. So we got to take that out in the pasture and drive it around, you know, and get used to shifting gears and steering and corners and chasing cows with a car. Poor cattle. We didn't do much of that, really. I had sympathy on the cattle. And they had sympathy on me, too, thank goodness. But we so that was our, you know, that was our learning experience. So I began gaining skills like that, because really, you know, you can't hot rod around the pasture without you pick up a few skills, you know. And of course, you're driving opportunities on the farm expand, you know, as you get a little older and get a little more size to you. And then you can start driving the trucks in the field and getting the dirty old chopped hay all over you. Or you can, like, you know, getting corn silage, things like that, getting sugar beets out of the field and hauling them to the dump. You can do all those kind of things time you're 7, 8 years old. You know, you're barely big enough to see over the wheel, man, but you're doing it. Of course, it's just short local stuff, mostly in the field, you know. Do a little bit of field to farm and stuff like that, but for the most part, we're staying off the roads till we're like 12, 13, maybe 10. You know, but by that time, somewhere there between 10 and 13, we like start driving the tractors, moving the equipment from field to field. Of course, we've been driving tractors by then. Full-time tractor work starts at about age 7, going on 8 maybe. And, you know, you learn how to drive in these big old circles and plow a field up and disc it down and, you know, get it all smooth and ready for planting. And of course, your old man does plant because he's the only one that can get the rows perfectly straight. You know, everybody else is asleep at the wheel and it looks like they've been drinking. You know, make crooked rows. You can't have that. It doesn't make for efficient harvesting or crop maintenance either. You know, you got to get in there and get the weeds out of them and so forth. I mean, you know, it's got to be straight. Got to run the water down the courses because you irrigate it all out in the West. For the most part, anyway, at least in that part of the West, you sure as heck do. So anyway, Dad would do the planting. But drive, drive, drive. And I'll tell you what, I couldn't help myself, because I'd sit there at night. Sometimes we'd camp out on what we call our big lawn. We lived, our little farmstead, you know, the headquarters of our operation, was right on the edge of this little farming community there in Utah, right against the mountains, like paradise, babies. I mean, just gorgeous. And we'd lay out there at night. Sometimes us kids get to sleep out there on the big lawn. And I mean, there wasn't so much light in the air, and you could see a big sky. It was like, man, we didn't know how precious that big sky was. Figured it'd last forever. It lasted this long, and you can't look up in the sky anywhere now and see it any longer. It's gone. A whole bunch of haze has come in to take its place. We've made a mess of things, dang it. But I would lay out there on that old blanket, or inside my little army surplus sleeping bag. What a piece of junk that was. It's colder in the bag than it was out of it, almost. No wonder it was surplus. Nobody could use them, man. They were junk. But anyway, we'd lay in those old sleeping bags out there on the big lawn looking at that star-scudded sky. And man, we'd hear them trucks coming into town there on Highway 91, jaking down and gearing down and coming through the underpasses and up the little hill into town, going about 30, 35 time they hit that place. You know, and there was just this wanderlust come up in me, you know, this feeling that, man, Those guys been to L.A. just a day or two ago, you know. Whatever L.A. is, I could see myself traveling across country in one of those big old rigs. It didn't take too big of a stretch of imagination, you know. But anyway, I just knew I liked the sound of a Jake and of a truck gearing down coming into town. I really thought that was awesome. Back in those days, the horsepower was way down there, you know. I mean, these guys really had to work. It'd take them a week, 2 weeks to go from Salt Lake City to L.A. Well, I exaggerate slightly, but 3-4 days. Which, you know, in my time, could be accomplished in 15 hours either way, you know what I mean? In just about any truck, you know, because they all had a little more horsepower then, and as time went on, they got a lot more. But back there at the beginning, you know, I thank God that we had those old tractors to learn on, and we had our little Plymouth play car, and Dad wouldn't let me buy my own car till I was like 14. And then, even if I had a car, I couldn't, like, you know, just drive it around until I had a license, and that was 15, you know. So for a year I had a car and no place to really ride it, so I made me a place. I went down the street where this big old warehouse was, and they had a great big old sand lot. It used to be my great-grandfather's backyard. But they had this big old sand lot there, you know. I mean, it was like maybe 20, 25 acres, you know, pretty good-sized place. And so I went out there with their permission and built me an oval track in the sand. The bank turns the whole nine yards, man. You know, this farm machinery is pretty handy for doing stuff like that. So pretty soon I have the creme de la creme of, you know, drag ovals, yeah. Racing ovals, you know, dirt track, baby. This is sand, man. And me and my old 47 straight 8 Buick used to go down there and just tear it up, man, you know. I learned how to slide around corners. Man, I got good on that track, but the neighbors got good and dirty in their houses because I was kicking dust a mile in the air every time I went around that thing. So they started complaining, and I wet the track down, but there was still way too much dust getting in the air, and so I had to quit. So what do I do now? I still got like 6 months to live before I can get my license, and I got my car. Unless I'm really incredibly sneaky, I'm not getting out of there with anything. You know what I mean? I'm not going down the road in that automobile if the old man has anything to say about it. And I know you guys don't have much discipline nowadays, but back in those days, man, you know, the discipline was administered pretty harshly. So you kind of tried to obey what your old man's wishes were. You know what I mean? I was already on probation for borrowing a car from a friend and taking it across state lines without permission and roaming around in that car for several months before they finally found us and brought us back, you know, me and my buddy. And I did that when I was just 13. And it was quite the experience. But by then I was driving good enough to be able to, I have to admit though, boy, the first time down the highway, especially in those canyons, back in those days, little twisty, turny, wavy things. Wow. But I had my hands full, but I got her done. You know, I remember going down Price Canyon in that borrowed car. I must have had 3 miles of traffic behind me, man. I tell you, I was going so slow down that canyon. But, you know, and there ain't no pull-outs, or I would have pulled over. I finally did find a pull-out down at the bottom down there and let them go by. But then we got out there on the desert, you could haul ass, and I was a little more accustomed to that, so it wasn't so bad. We got by. Pretty soon you couldn't tell us from the most seasons of drivers, you know what I mean? We were good, and that's why we got away with it for several months. But it was because of my background, my farming and ranching background. You know, kids start really young then, you know. Everybody thinks it's such a horrible thing now for kids to be working. Well, hell, I wasn't working in no coal mine. And I, you know, crawling on my belly, getting coal, no way. You know, I wasn't forced labor in a factory. You know, it was a family thing, you know, and I didn't get along too well with my family right from the beginning because we were just different, you know. And in fact, you know, these days I even know why, how the difference came in. You can't imagine. You know, one point in my life, I woke up in this little apartment in Boulder, Colorado. This is several years back. Many years back, in fact. Now, well, years go by like wink of an eye, you know. But anyway, many years back, I was like hanging out in this apartment there. I woke up one day, and I realized, you know, from what my sisters had told me, that I was probably living within 3 feet of the place where I was conceived, you know? And I remembered then seeing the energy of that time when I was in some healing modes in my life. Well, it's always healing, but angels came and took me back to that time and helped me see and remember it, you know, where I was watching from afar, no close-up stuff here, as, you know, my little person was being conceived here in the earthbound reality. And then I watched as the beings and presences that work with us came on down and modified the embryonic existence and the mother's womb so that my energy could be extended into it, you know. And that all come flooding back to me when I was living in that apartment, and I'm looking at this hotel right next door, 3 feet from me, which used to be back in the day that I was created, it was like a little motor court hotel, you know. There'd be two units and then a parking for two cars, and they're like little cabins, more like than they are these plastic, artificial, synthetic hotels we live in now when we travel. They suck. But there's a lot of luxury there, but they still suck, you know. The old motor courts had some character, you know. I mean, what better place for a vagabond such as myself as to create the opening for themselves? And by the way, this is what we do, you know. We, as spirits, we're around when these kind of things are going on, and we're kind of designing ourselves into it, you know, patterning it in, you know, getting ready for the leap where you finally enter into the existence within the mother's womb and start becoming yourself. It takes a little time. But we're always there for the whole process. You know, we're attached to our mothers right from those beginning moments. So our consciousness is presence there all the time. Unless we disattach in some way, you know, the baby dies or there's a miscarriage or something like that. And outside of that, we're still there, baby. And we're with our mothers, you know, from before the point of conception to, of course, beyond our birth, because even though there's a physical separation, the spiritual separation takes quite a bit longer, 2 or 3 years for most of us. Some are a little quicker than others, you know, but for the most part, it's 2 or 3 years, you know, just to, well, as you say, disattach from the mother. We're never completely disattached from her. We wear the mark of the mother on us, whether we're male or female, you know. It's just there. Reminds us that we're all extended from the mother. That mother's energy is the cradle of life. That from which life springs forward and becomes living and begins its experiences and goes through them. That's all, Mother. It's a beautiful thing, ain't it, Angel? Yes, it is. Beautiful ass thing. Yeah, so that was quite the deal. And I realized the light. But, you know, and I was shown what happened, all the energies, how things were changed around and stuff. You know, so like when I say I was born to drive,
I was born with,
no, more like a hyperdrive. Much different in this existence from those around me, yet very much the same, but unable, almost from the beginning of my life, and it's a source of, you know, agony for me, but all, from the beginning, all unable to accommodate myself into this world in any real sort of way, you know, which is another reason why trucking comes into being. Because it's created for those of us in existence to give us a place to go and feel like productive citizens, make a little money and make a life for ourselves. Yeah, there's not a whole lot of family life left in it, you know. You don't get... I've been fortunate. I've had some jobs that did get me home quite often, but... And sometimes for extended periods, but for the most part, you know, you're on the road, you're on the road. That's where you live. Home is where you visit, you know. It's not the greatest existence, and I've had those local jobs that, you know, you still wind up working 12 to 18 hours a day, sometimes 24. You know, so you're, you know, during the week and maybe even the weekends if you're working for the wrong outfit, you see less of home than you do when you're working long haul. And long haul's a sure a lot less stress than running local, let me tell you. So there's reasons why once you're on the road, you stay on the road, you know. But it starts back there in your childhood and with beings like me that even though my mother's womb could be made to accommodate me, whatever that frickin' means, I know my energy's different. But beyond that, this life couldn't stretch enough. I couldn't shrink enough to accommodate myself into it. So there was conflict from the beginning of my life, you know. Mother had this nervous breakdown and went away. And, you know, I got passed to the wet nurses and raised by my aunt and my sister, and, you know, for a year or so. And then things started coming back to some, but by then I'm already like, you know, resistant, though I'm a very mellow child, but resistant, you know. And as I get a little bit older, I'm hearing and seeing all these loving sounds and these warm feelings, but at the same time I'm like, wow, there's something not right with this existence, and you start getting edgy. And that's when you start feeling the restlessness come up, that early on. And it's almost virtually assured from that moment in time, not 2-3 years old, that if you're going to be a trucker, that's where it happens. And you'll find that not only do you have a proclivity for wandering, moving around, that you also have a drive, you're driven pretty harshly at times to see something better in this life, to do something different that'll make it better. Because you sure as hell don't want to leave it the shit heap that you stepped into as a child, you know. It's always unpleasant and sometimes downright traumatic. In fact, for most it is, and some a lot worse than others. And my parents were good and sincere-hearted people that meant well to do by their children, and I bear them no ill will whatsoever. I love them dearly. But from the early stages of life, we just did not get along, because on the other side of their compassion was a series of brainwashing that had gone on with them that, like, left them in this place where they were thoroughly indoctrinated by a certain philosophy that had a lot of rules and regulations and a pretty obscure point of view as to the reason for living and, you know, the existence of God and all this kind of stuff. So, quite a lot of conflict in our home, you know. And a lot of coldness to boot, because, you know, real feelings, genuineness, while there was a good share of it, just didn't seem to be all that common. I don't know how to describe it beyond that, but it was a difficult environment for all of us that were in it, and it was a large family. Ultimately, there were a dozen of us children, one mother, poor gal, and I'd have a few nervous breakdowns, too. In fact, I'd be in the Bahamas, man, let somebody else take care of those brats. Raise them up good, Papa. Oh, God. But that's when you know you're driven, you know, when you start at those ages, getting that kind of conscious, those kind of consciousness, those kind of restless feelings, you know it's going to be a life. And then, you're conscious that they, whoever they are, know of your existence. They know who you are. Whatever that means you're different. So they're watching you from early times and just biding their time and waiting for their opportunity to corrupt you and total you up for this lifetime, so you'll be like in a straitjacket for the rest of forever inside, I mean, and won't be able to interfere with, quote, their solutions for everything, which are pretty dark and deceiving and shit like that, you know? Life built on lies, you know? But they, you know, they're visible to me. I can see them, I can feel their energy. But, you know, I'm a child. I doubt myself greatly. But at the same time, you know, some of the people held out to be really nice and charming to me are like the devil in disguise. But I don't think the devil's so bad even then. You know, it's like this exaggerated idea of good and evil, of it being constantly butting heads, that's insane. And why would good ever bother, and why would evil even want to try? I mean, you know, we've created this illusion, this stretched and warped reality, you know, for the purpose of testing ourselves, but nothing truthfully exists like that. You know, there's been attempts and trials to bring humanity in particular into a place like that, to where there'd be continual conflict forever so that other beings could feed. I mean, you know, this is all comes from that idea of division and separation and superiority and inferiority, which, you know, based on judgment, you know, which is crap. But when you start becoming conscious, shit like this is a little child. When you feel your feelings and then there's music comes along that just feeds it, then you know you're different. And you know you don't fit in, you feel it, you see it on every level. But you're a little kid, you want to please, you want to love and be loved. And man, it makes it difficult. I know a lot of you out there know what I'm talking about. And there's been a lot of beans thrown into this haystack. But we're all sprouted out now, and guess what? We own the haystack. It's all come back to us. Been a long journey, a hell of a lot of trucking, but there you are. So that's your humble beginnings. Wanderlust, a certain amount of early on despair in a childlike sense, which ain't like being depressed as an adult, but a certain amount of despair, because you just think, man, what am I doing here? And then they start about talking about living forever, and you're looking around just saying, oh my God, I don't know if I want to live another 3 days, let alone forever. You just can't fathom it. It doesn't seem right. Because, you know, even though you're in the fullness of life already, you've kind of lost some of the appreciation. You're not seeing it as good as you did when you first started. But that's normal here. You dim it down, go away, just so you can find yourself and come back. It's a beautiful journey in the end. Point A to point B. As usual. Okay, buckaroos, we'll catch you in chapter 6, pick up sticks, or 7, go to heaven, whatever, you know. But we love you. You know, I'm glad that we're driven, that there's a lot of us here that can't sit still until we've done something to make it right. That's the end to disharmony right there. And the beginning of a whole new phase of this experience we call Earth and sky. Till next time, sisters and brothers, rock and roll.